Rush!
Unbelievable.
Not exactly a fairy tale beginning, huh, Prince Noctis?
We let ourselves get carried away.
Look! These things happen.
Hola, comrades. Today's topic of interest, Final Fantasy 15. The word in that title, which I want to talk about, is fantasy. The idea of what fantasy even is has been fluctuating in recent years. In basic terms, fantasy is any work that involves concepts that are not possible in our world and never have a chance of becoming possible. Think magic, wizards, dragons, etc. Where exactly the difference between fantasy and science fiction stands is debatable, however, and the two can coexist. Tonally, however, there has traditionally been a contrast between the two since at least the end of the space race, when sci-fi took a turn from the chrome and astronauts and optimism that had defined it previously into something more gritty and existential. Cyberpunk was born here, and its influence was immediately felt. Fantasy, however, mostly stayed the same. It was not as whimsical as Disney films, many of which softened the elements of the stories they adapted, would have you believe, but it was still regarded as something frivolous, something childish, where there was black and white, as opposed to works that took place in our world, which showcased more gray. This made sense. Fantasy has traditionally been an engine of wish fulfillment. If you're too weary to accept the world you're in, why not create a new one? It can be imaginative and endlessly creative, but in the end, it will boil down to the good guys versus the bad guys. Because we yearn for that. The world is confusing. Would it not be much easier to pretend that there were no tough decisions? That everything came down to being brave or courageous or self-sacrificing enough to overcome our challenges and save our world or the people we care about? Would it not be easier to believe that what you need to succeed can be pinned down to a handful of platitudes and morals? That the world is not random and wild and chaotic, but simple and easy to understand? However, somewhere in the last 25 years or so, we started to depart from that. Fantasy started borrowing heavily from science fiction. As I said, the distinction between them has always been foggy, in using its setting to tackle heavy issues. Not everything would be alright, and even if it turned out that way, the characters, who are real people with real problems instead of idealized caricatures, would have to suffer and bleed. It was less about clear good and clear evil, and much more about people trying to figure themselves and their world out. This is why the A Song of Ice and Fire series has become such a major hit. It represents the starkest possible break from the Tolkienian concept of fantasy. Which brings us to Final Fantasy XV. The Final Fantasy series started off steeped in almost laughably cliche fantasy elements, and getting away with it because of decent storytelling and compelling gameplay, especially for its time. Over time, the series evolved, reaching its apex in a mix of intensely thoughtful and ambitious fantasy storytelling that was stopped from drowning in its own grandiosity by interesting and dynamic work with characters and relationships. This is 6 through 10, the best run in the series. From there, they lost the personal touch somewhat in 12, and then were swallowed in pretension and nonsense in 13. The grandiose fantasy storytelling had become overcooked and turgid and flat, deprived of the ambition that made its past aims for bombastic narrative work, complete with stale and uninteresting characters. So, to my pleasant surprise, in Final Fantasy XV, they decided to go in exactly the opposite direction. And the result is certainly my favorite Final Fantasy game since 10, and one of my favorites in the series. Yes, there are still the trappings of epic fantasy, but they're not the focus, and thankfully so. Aside from the Baroque-esque soundtrack, which aches with vibrant emotional swells that are decidedly more European than is typical for the series but deliver both atmospherically and musically, the attempts to pump up the story to the level of great myth fall painfully short. There's all this talk of politics and ancient evils and curses, and while it's better than what 12 did, if only because this game doesn't lean as hard on the idea that these trappings are absolutely fascinating, it's too jumbled to work, and the music is forced to carry more than a few scenes by itself. No, what works are the more grounded elements. This is essentially a game about a road trip. You have four characters, and they drive across the world. That doesn't sound like much, especially compared to the more overtly fantastical elements that unfortunately overtake the story, but the interaction between these characters is nothing less than charming and compelling. The relationships between them, forged by arguments and challenges, but also by teamwork and fireside chats, and silly little moments like Prompto taking pictures of everyone, are strong. The characters care about one another, and so the player grows to care about them as well. Even though the characters individually are far from the best in the Final Fantasy franchise, it is the apotheosis of the idea that the whole is more than the sum of its parts. These characters don't know what the future holds for them, and a part of each of them regrets embarking on this journey in the first place, but they don't waver because they have one another. There is lighthearted jesting, and there is intense commiseration, and each works better because the other exists. While the scoring of the friendship between these two, with Stand By Me, could have been laughably kitsch, the game earns it. Seriously. These are four people of different backgrounds and social statuses, but as they travel, those distinctions disappear, and they're just four confused people attempting to figure out themselves and the world around them. The blending of fantasy with reality was a heavy selling point of this game, and it works, just not how it was intended. The fantastic elements are, compared to the journey of the four main characters, hollow and absurd. Meanwhile, the touted realistic elements, if we're going to define realism in the way that it is usually defined in gaming, fall very flat. They either add nothing or are patently absurd, such as the now infamous cup noodles advertisement, which is so blatant and obvious that it almost circles back around to being hilarious.
Then, if you take something already delicious like cup noodles and add in the finest, freshest ingredients, what do you get? The ultimate flavor experience. So I ask you, Noct, what's your favorite ingredient? That's what I'm talking about. Minced meat is the key to every perfect cup of noodles. But why stop there? I say we outdo the ordinary. Find ourselves some real good meat that'll surpass perfection. You know something? Going through all that trouble to make our own custom cup, it's made me appreciate cup noodles even more.
Perhaps we truly can't improve upon perfection.
It's not about finding the single best ingredient. It's about crafting that perfect blend of meat, egg, and shrimp. That harmony of flavors is key.
While the game is beautiful, it fails to deliver realism in how gamers define that term. However, it fits directly into the artistic idea of that term. Realism in art is not just about depicting things as they are, which takes no creativity or imagination or artistry. If you succeed at drawing a notebook exactly as it is, you've only succeeded in creating a worse version of a photograph. Yay for you. A historical movie that makes recreating the exact past its primary focus is just a low-quality documentary. True realism is not about pixel count or making deserts as brown as possible, and it certainly isn't about portraying the world as a pit of misery and sadness through which no light can shine. No, it's about focusing primarily not on grand schemes or luscious mythology or monumental ideologies, but rather on the struggles and relationships and emotions of ordinary people. Gustave Flaubert's Madame Bovary is perhaps the best example of this. I think that artistic definition fits well with the most effective moments of Final Fantasy XV. Of course, even those moments are not pure realism, as the quest these four comrades embark on is through a fantastic land with a fantastical objective, and even if that were not the case, Noctis being a prince with a great, grandiose destiny stops this from being realism. But the form and the shape of the adventures is the form and the shape of realism. Like the best adventure fiction, it's not about the destination, but about how the experiences and sensations of the journey, including the interactions between those partaking in the journey, challenge and change the characters and their perspectives. The external journey is less interesting than the internal journeys of the characters as they search for personal connection in a world that is very silent and unknown. However, the fact that it is still heavily doused in fantasy changes and shapes the road trip. It provides a moral and justifiable template for the road trip, for one. Yes, this could be found without the fantasy framework, but that would require more contrivances. Secondly, and much more importantly, the road trip is made more interesting because they're traveling through a fantasy world. While a straight road trip can be made fascinating in books, most famously in Kerouac's seminal On the Road, in visual media, a constant bombardment of spectacle is needed, and if there are only towns and roads and street signs, then the characters may be enjoying themselves, but you, the player, are not because you're receiving very little new information. You're not compelled, you're not stimulated. A fantasy road trip, meanwhile, is better at sharing that joy of travel with the player. Because of the four stereotypical characters becoming more than that by the bonds forged between them as they travel through a dangerous world they never would have imagined traveling through before, a logical comparison might be made between this game and The Lord of the Rings. And that's fair. The burden Frodo was forced to bear for the sake of the world and the permanent psychological damage that burden inflicted upon him are far more interesting than the great struggle of good versus evil. But The Lord of the Rings was too formal, too elevated, too concerned with duty and great struggles to be an apt comparison. The characters are never allowed to stay vulnerable or to seriously contemplate the world. They never break out of the heroic mold, out of that simple framework. Lord of the Rings is more of a capital R romantic work, which is exactly what realism was reacting against when it first formed as a major artistic movement in the middle of the 19th century. A more apt comparison would be the latest mainline entry in the Star Wars series, The Last Jedi. Both Final Fantasy and Star Wars are franchises that once managed to balance somewhat grounded character work with larger scale fantasy storytelling, but then lost the character work piece and collapsed under their own mythological and political bloat, then recovered by reacting against those failed entries entirely and dropping the contrived trappings to focus more on characters and relationships. The Last Jedi works much better because Rey and Kylo Ren are far more compelling and have far more interesting struggles than the four boys of Final Fantasy XV, but both are at their hearts about people responding to a world that did not work as they initially envisioned by becoming closer and forming rich personal connections. Final Fantasy XV is a great game. It's not great because of its love story, which is not terrible, but is significantly worse than both Squall and Rinoa's love story in 8 and Tidus and Yuna's in 10. It's not great because of the plot and the villain, which are both forgettable. It's not great because of the dialogue or the side quests, or any of the characters except for the four main protagonists and maybe Iris. It's not even great because of the characters as individuals. It's great because this is one of the few games, no, one of the few pieces of art, which understands that the time the characters spend interacting and building relationships is as important as the time they spend completing missions directly related to the central plot. By the game's conclusion, what struck a chord is not that Nocta saved the world and was able to be together with his love, but that he and his three companions found meaning in the relationships they shared with one another.
It's more than I can take.
It's fascinating how our use of fantasy has changed. In a way, yes, we still use it to fulfill our collective hopes and ideals, but those ideals have changed, and this change is for the better. There's less a focus on defeating a great evil. That's too abstract, and now that less of us, especially the younger generations, buy into the narrative about the singular great outside evil that needs to be defeated, we need smaller scale, more personal hopes and ideals to aspire to. Is it not true that we enjoy Harry Potter less because we dream of being able to defeat a great evil, and more because we dream of having a pack of friends who will love us and support us and protect us and push us in the right direction? That's what we're moving toward as a world. We may not know if there's a great evil to defeat, but we know that we aspire to form personal connections with one another in this crazed world, and we like to hope that that is possible. So if you liked what you saw today, consider donating to my Patreon so I can produce even more grounded content. Also, don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, all that personal stuff. Adios, comrades!